Hey everybody, welcome to Sunday night at FBC Van Online. We're so grateful that you came to join with us together. We're going to continue our study here in the book of Ezekiel. And again, I know I say this every single week, but again, this is going to be kind of a unique sermon, a unique study as we march our way through, as we continue walking through the book of Ezekiel. It's unique because the book of Ezekiel is unique. There are so many different genres represented here. There's so many different topics. There's so many different ways that God communicates with his people. And so we have to treat each of these kind of uniquely. And so we're going to enter into a section of the book of Ezekiel from chapter 25 through chapter 32. And we're going to call that God's glory in judgment. God's glory in judgment. So what we're going to see in these chapters is a series of judgments, a series of statements that God is making these pronouncements of judgment against the nations surrounding Israel, against the nations that have been antagonistic toward Israel throughout their history. And so he's going to talk about Ammon, Moab, Edom, Philistia, Tyre and Sidon, Egypt, and Assyria. And so we're going to kind of look at this. So we're going to look at this a little bit differently this evening. So each prophecy is going to follow kind of a similar format. We see the same thing each and every time. We see the nation is identified, like who is God talking about? Then we see the crime is explained. This is the reason why there has to be judgment. Then we see the sentence is given. So like what is going to happen to these nations? And then number four, we see the result is promised. So each and every one of these things we see here in the judgments concerning each of these nations. And the neat thing is in almost every single one of these, the result given is the phrase that we've been talking about all the way through the book of Ezekiel, then they will know that I am the Lord. Remember, that's the center of this book. God's glory is the center of this book. And so he's saying, I'm going to judge these different nations that have antagonized my people, and then these nations will know that I am the Lord. For generations, these enemy nations surrounding Israel had harassed them, attacked them, sought their downfall. They had allied against them. They had enticed them with their pagan gods. They had done all of these things to bring Israel's defeat. So now we see God in a moment of encouragement toward his people. He turns his gaze toward the nations around them, and he promises vengeance against them. Why is that encouragement to the people of Israel? Imagine it like this. They've been listening to God's pronouncement of judgment against them now for like 24 chapters. It's a long time to be hearing the list of their sins and what they've done wrong and what God is going to do to them. Well, now God takes a break and he says, listen, you are my chosen people. I love you. And so these nations around you that have antagonized you, I'm going to cast my judgment against them. It's Israel looking and saying, there's a moment of relief here. There's a moment of encouragement because my enemies are about to be destroyed. And so we see this theme all the way through Scripture as well. The prophet Joel, this is what he wrote about the nations around Israel. He said, swing the sickle because the harvest is ripe. Come and trample the grapes because the wine press is full. The wine vats overflow because the wickedness of the nations is extreme. And so Joel, that was in chapter 3, verse 13 of the book of Joel. So he was saying as well, God is going to bring judgment on the wicked nations surrounding Israel. God is going to bring the full weight of his glory to bear against these nations that have antagonized his people. So this is what we're going to do this evening. This is why it's going to look a little different. We're going to look at each of the sections, each of these nations that God is judging. And what I want to do is look at their history throughout Scripture. Because if we're kind of going to read this out of context, when I read, we'll talk about this, but if I just read one of these prophecies of judgment against the people of Ammon, we can sit here and say, okay, that's great, but who in the world are the people of Ammon? Like, why is God doing this? And so I want to take some time to look at the histories of these nations within the whole of Scripture and see why God is doing what he's doing, why these pronouncements are coming. We're going to see, this is going to give us a picture of why God is so angry with these nations and why they deserve to be punished. One of the things it's also going to do, and this is what I'm most excited about as I present this, is that these histories of these nations, they're going to connect all the scripture together. It's going to give us a wonderful picture of biblical theology, how all the scripture kind of pieces together and how it all fits into the grand narrative of the story of redemption that scripture is about. So that's what I want to do. I want to go through each of these nations, and we'll briefly kind of just hit the main bullet points of where they show up in the story of the people of Israel. One resource, if you haven't already downloaded it, I would love for you to pause this video right now and take advantage of this resource. We put the link in the description of this video. We've posted it on our website. We've posted it on Facebook in different places, but it is the handout for tonight. It has 5 pages, and this is everything that I'm going to be going through tonight. I know I will not be able to stop and read every one of these verses. I will not be able to go through as much as I would like to, and so I would love for you to grab a copy of that and follow along. That will really help you be able to kind of understand what's going on and where we're walking through. So you can grab that. You can click on the link in the description of this video you're watching right now. Or you can go to our website, fbcvan.org. It's on the homepage under the little box that says Ezekiel. Or you can look at our Facebook page. It's linked there as well. So we would love for you to go ahead and take a moment to do that and make sure you have that before we get started. Okay, so if you've got a copy of your Bible and a copy of the handout, the Ezekiel Part 10 handout for tonight, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we will start to make our way through each of these different judgments that we see here in Ezekiel 25 through 32. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this opportunity I have to speak. I pray that whoever is listening to this and whoever will listen throughout this next week, I pray that you would bless them for their faithfulness in opening your word. I know that this isn't a very common passage to preach, but I do pray that you would help us to glean from this words of truth. I pray that you would show us, like you said in the book of 2 Timothy, that all scripture is inspired, it's God-breathed, and it's profitable for us. I pray that you would help us to invest our lives in this book. Lord, give us strength in this strange time that we're living in. Give us peace and encouragement. Help us to understand why we need the story of judgment. Lord, that this world is bound for judgment. But we have this great and precious promise that if we believe in Jesus as our Savior and we've been born again, then we will never see condemnation. We will never taste judgment because you took our judgment in our place. Thank you, Father, for the gift of the gospel. I pray as we study Ezekiel that you would be glorified, that God's glory would be at the center of this study and as it is the center of this book that we're going through. Father, thank you for everybody watching. Bless them in the name of Jesus. In your name, amen. Okay, so we're not going to be able to read every single verse. If we read every verse from chapter 25 all the way through 32, we'd be here all night. So what I want to do, I would love for you to read this on your own. If you really want to see what God has placed in his word and how he is moving and speaking through his word, I'd encourage you to read all these words. What I want to do first, I want to give an example of what this is going to look like by reading through the first judgment. It's in chapter 25, verses 1 through 7, and it's the judgment against Ammon. We're going to talk that through, and then you're going to see that throughout these next few chapters, it's going to follow the similar pattern like we talked about a little bit earlier. So let's look at Ezekiel chapter 25 in verse 1, and let's walk through those first 7 verses. It says, "Then the word of the Lord came to me," that's Ezekiel, "Son of man, face the Ammonites and prophesy against them. Say to the Ammonites, hear the word of the Lord God. This is what the Lord God says, because you said, aha, about my sanctuary when it was desecrated, about the land of Israel when it was laid waste, and about the house of Judah when they went into exile. Therefore, I am about to give you to the people of the east as a possession. They will set up their encampments and pitch their tents among you. They will eat your fruit and drink your milk. I will make Rabbah a pasture for camels and Ammon a resting place for sheep. Then you will know that I am the Lord. For this is what the Lord God says, because you clapped your hands, stamped your feet, and rejoiced over the land of Israel with wholehearted contempt. Therefore, I am about to stretch out my hand against you and give you as plunder to the nations. I will cut you off from the people and eliminate you from the nations. I will destroy you, and you will know that I am the Lord. So that's kind of a picture of what we're about to see. That is a severe judgment. That is a moment of absolute vengeance from the Lord. He's saying, because when my people were in distress, you laughed at them. You rejoiced. He says, you rejoiced over the land of Israel with wholehearted contempt. You were absolutely vicious to your neighbors, and so I am going to judge you. That's what God is saying to these people of Ammon. That's the similar pattern that we're going to see displayed over the next few chapters. And so let's talk about the people of Ammon for a second. The people of Ammon, where did this nation begin? When did they enter into the biblical picture? Well, they started way back in the book of Genesis, chapter 19. If you remember the story of Lot and his family, they lived in the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. When God cast judgment on those two cities, Lot and his family escaped. And if you remember the story, his wife looked back toward the city of Sodom and turned into a pillar of salt. Well, Lot and his two daughters escaped the city. They're living in a cave. His two daughters look around and say, there's no men. We're never going to be married. We're never going to have children. And so they get their father drunk and they sleep with him. It's this hideous moment in the book of Genesis. It just shows the absolute depravity of humanity, especially the people that have turned their back on the Lord. And so Lot, out of that moment, he ends up having two sons. One of them is named Ben-Ami. That son named Ben-Ami becomes the father of this people group called Ammon, or the Ammonites. They're going to plague the people of Israel for the rest of the story, up until this moment we see. So God gave the Ammonites, the land of the Ammonites, he gave that to as an inheritance, a possession for the children of Lot. And the Israelites were commanded throughout Scripture in Deuteronomy, in Numbers, and in 2 Chronicles not to invade or attack them, okay? Because they were relatives in a sense. Ammonites, on the other hand, though, were forbidden from joining Israel. So God says, don't treat them poorly because they are your family, but also don't let them come to Thanksgiving dinner. And so we see that in the book of Deuteronomy. Jephthah, now we're moving deeper into the story. Jephthah, the judge, in the book of Judges, chapter 10, he liberated Israel from the Ammonite people. They had conquered Israel during that time, and Jephthah, he liberated them. King Saul, King David, King Jehoshaphat, and King Jotham, and we're talking all the way through the story of the kings in Israel, they all waged war at some point against the people of Ammon. King Solomon, now we're moving deeper into the story, King Solomon married women from Ammon. We read that in 1 Kings chapter 11, and he worshipped gods of Ammon. King Solomon's wife Naamah was an Ammonite, and she gave birth to the next king, Rehoboam. We read that in the book of 1 Kings 14. The Ammonites discouraged, moving even deeper into the story, or further into the story, the Ammonites discouraged Israel from rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem. They actively antagonized Israel in the book of Nehemiah chapter 2. When they were trying to build the walls, they were antagonizing them. Jeremiah prophesied against Ammon, as did Amos and the prophet Zephaniah. So we see that's their whole history. We see that they've constantly kind of been in friction with the people of Israel all the way throughout. And then so here we reach the book of Ezekiel chapter 25, and God says, because of all this, I'm going to judge you. I'm going to destroy you. Now, there's a really interesting thing. I wanted to end this section here in the book of Jeremiah chapter 49. There's an incredible promise given that one day God will restore the fortunes of the people of Ammon. That is a huge promise. That is a grace-filled promise. When you're looking at all the history of what they've done to the people of Israel, for God to then look and say, listen, I will restore you. One day you'll return to me. So you can read that in Jeremiah chapter 49. So that's the story of the people of Ammon. That's how we're going to treat each and every one of these sections. All I'm going to do is we're going to talk about the judgment that's going to come on them and then who they were as a people group. Some of these judgments are very short. Ammon was just 7 verses, but then again, some of the judgments that we're going to read about later are going to stretch chapters, the ones especially about Philistia, about Egypt, and about Assyria. So that was the story of Ammon. I don't know, there's more. If you want to go deeper in depth into this idea of who these people groups were, I would love to sit down with you at some point and do that. If I got some history lovers that would love to do that, man, I would love to sit down with you. But for our purposes, let's just walk quickly through this. So we've looked at Ammon. The next judgment we see in Ezekiel 25 is against Moab. In Ezekiel 25, verse 11, he says, "I will execute judgments against Moab." So who what was Moab? Who were the Moabites? Well, actually, we see their origin was the same as the people of Ammon. It was the from that drunken encounter between Lot and his daughters, he had another son named Moab. And we see that in Genesis 19. He became the founder of the peoples of Moab. There's some interesting things, though, that intersect in the story of Israel with the people of Moab. King Balak of Moab, when the people of Israel were moving through the wilderness to the promised land, King Balak of Moab paid a man named Balaam. If you remember this story, it's in Numbers chapters 22 through 24. He paid this prophet named Balaam to prophesy against the people of Israel, but God used that moment and Balaam ended up blessing Israel instead. Remember, he kept trying to curse Israel, but instead words of blessing poured out. And what he ended up doing was cursing Moab instead. It's this really funny moment. You see that in Numbers chapter 24. Later in the story, Moab lured Israel into sin by intermarrying with them. So they kind of brought their gods and their goddesses, their idols, their pagan system of worship. They began to infect the people of Israel. God gave the land of the Moabites to the ancestors of Lot as an inheritance. And the people, again, just as the same with Ammon, the people of Israel were commanded not to invade that land. Moabites were forbidden from joining Israel, so they were not welcome at the Thanksgiving table either. And Israel, another stories is they were about to go into the promised land. They were forbidden, they were not permitted to enter into the land of Moab, so they had to go the long way around. That created a lot of hard feelings between those two nations. One very, very interesting thing, before Israel reaches the promised land, Moses dies in the wilderness, and he's actually buried in the land of Moab. So we read about that in Deuteronomy chapter 34. Kind of an interesting moment there. Now connecting forward like we did with Ammon to the judges, Ehud the judge liberated Israel from the Moabites. The Moabites had taken over the land, and Ehud, in Judges chapter 3, liberates them from that. We also read connecting stories that Ruth, the grandmother of King David, was a Moabite woman. We read about that in Ruth chapter 1, verse 4. Then we read about that, as we move into the story, King Saul and King David both waged war at some point in their reign against Moab. King Solomon, again, we've read about him a few times. King Solomon married women from Moab and he began to worship their gods. Another story we see with Moab in the story of Israel is that after King Ahaz died, Moab waged war against Israel. So they attacked Israel, but Judah, this is after the division of the kingdoms, Judah came to Israel's aid and defeated Moab in this massive battle in 2 Kings chapter 3. Now, in the prophecy, we see Isaiah prophesy against Moab, as did Jeremiah, Amos, and Zephaniah. So we see that's the whole history of the people of Moab and Israel. They've constantly been in conflict. But again, in Jeremiah chapter 48, verse 47, God makes a promise to restore the fortunes of the people of Moab. So that shows who God is, God's character of grace and mercy, even though here we're reading in Ezekiel chapter 25 about judgment. So that's Ammon, that's Moab. Next, the shortest one here that we're going to read about is the people of Edom. The people of Edom. I thought it was so ironic. I've been preaching about this and this judgment against Edom, and then we moved to a location where there's a little community called Edom. And so I got to always make sure to put that little thing in there. Edom is a different thing. We're not casting judgment against the community down there with Edom. Pastor Craig at FBC Edom is one of my great friends, and I love partnering together with his church. We just did youth camp together with them, and so I think that's ironic and funny that We're going to talk about judgment against Edom, but it's a different Edom. So who was Edom? Where did this start? Because here in chapter 25 of Ezekiel, verse 14, God says, I will take my vengeance on Edom according to my anger and wrath. So there had to be something that caused God to be that angry at these people. Well, so where did they start? They started with the story of Jacob. Jacob's twin brother was named Esau, but he was also called Edom, which means red. And because he came out and he was like a red, hairy baby. It says this in Genesis 36, Esau was the father of the Edomites. And he had married four pagan women, and they were the ones that kind of founded this nation in Genesis 26. So Israel was not permitted to cross through the land of Edom to the promised land. On their way to the promised land, so they went the long way around. We read about that just the same as in Moab. Again, it creates hard feelings. Like, why don't you just let us through? Why do we have to go around? So that's kind of the first conflict. We read that Aaron died in the wilderness. He's the brother of Moses, and he was buried there in the land of Edom in Numbers chapter 20. Balaam the seer, we talked about that in the section of Moab, he prophesied against Edom. Even though he was trying to curse the people of Israel, he ended up cursing some of the nations around. Then if you move forward in the story, in the book of Deuteronomy, God commands something really interesting. He commands Israel to show kindness to the Edomites, and it says in Deuteronomy 23, verse 7, because he is your brother. So this, again, it shows God's character of grace and mercy, that even though Edom had refused them entry to walk through the land, God has said, you need to show them kindness as your brother. Way forward in the story, during the time of King Saul, there was a man named Doeg who was an Edomite. And he was a snitch, he was a murderer, and he had informed King Saul that David had been in this city called Nob, or this village called Nob. And so Saul sent this man Doeg, the Edomite, to slaughter all the people in this city. It's a nasty story there in 1 Samuel 22, but that's kind of a representative of the people of Edom. King Saul waged war against Edom, but it was David who finally conquered them. And we see that in 2 Samuel 8. In fact, he killed 18,000 Edomites in one single battle. He carried gold and silver as plunder from the people of Edom. Joab, who is King David's military commander, slaughtered everybody, all the males in the land of Edom, except for one guy who fled down to Egypt. King Solomon, again, remember, he keeps coming up in every one of these. He married women from Edom and ended up worshiping their gods as well. Edom went to war against Moab as an ally of Judah and Israel in the time of Jehoshaphat, just a kind of interesting moment there. Edom rebelled against Judah in King Jehoram's reign, and they appointed their own king. They said, we're no longer gonna bow down to you in Judah, and so we're gonna have our own king. And we see they defeated Judah in battle in 2 Chronicles 21, and it says in 2 Kings chapter 8 that they are still in rebellion against Judah's control today. King Amaziah of Judah defeated Edom in battle, killing 10,000 Edomites in a single day. But the victory ended up being short-lived because he ended up worshiping the gods of Edom. That was the big problem with all these nations around. Every time that they came into contact with Israel, Israel ended up worshiping their gods. It happens over and over. And so eventually, he was defeated in battle by the king of Israel in 2 Chronicles 25. When you look at the prophets, Isaiah prophesied against Edom, as did Jeremiah and Joel, Amos, Obadiah, and Malachi. So there's some significant times of prophecy against that nation. So we've looked at the people of Ammon, the people of Moab, the people of Edom. I know that this is just kind of bullet points of facts. This is kind of just what we're looking at. And I know you may be sitting here thinking, well, what does this have to do with anything? What does this have to do with me? Listen, we're walking through the book of Ezekiel. And we have to really fully understand, trying to be very gentle here, but we have to fully understand the Bible's not about us. All right. So there's not going to be every verse where you can pull out and say, oh, that's about me and encouraging my walk with Christ. No, we read scripture because it's God's word. We read the Bible because he spoke it and it teaches us about who he is, not about who I am. Because we see this, honestly, when we look at the judgment pronounced against each of these people groups, we should be looking and saying that judgment should fall on me as a sinner, as a person who was born in iniquity and lived and was living in rebellion against the holy God. These judgments should fall on me. But instead, God, in His grace, in His love, in His patience, and in His mercy, sent Jesus Christ to come and take that judgment on Himself. To hang on Calvary's cross and take all of that sin, all of the things that you have done and will do in the future. He took it on Himself. He took all the penalty for sinful humanity. He drank that suffering down to the dregs. And now in replace, in return, He offers freedom from that sin. He offers redemption and forgiveness. He offers an invitation to come back into fellowship with God Himself. Offers the Holy Spirit as a token, as a seal for the day of redemption. And He offers a home in heaven for us when we pass out of this earthly life. This is what this is all about. That's what judgment illustrates. That God is going to judge sin, but there is a way to redemption through the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. That's why we read this. So if you're sitting here thinking, I don't understand why I have to listen to all these bullet points. Listen, this is why, because it points us to the truth of Jesus Christ and His finished work for us on Calvary's cross. So we looked at Ammon, Moab, and Edom. Now let's look at the nation of Philistia, the Philistines. In verse 17 of chapter 25, he says, I will execute severe vengeance against Philistia with furious rebukes. Okay, so where did the people of Philistia start? They started actually earlier than the others in Genesis chapter 9, after Noah cursed his son Ham. And his grandson, Canaan, after they were cursed, Ham had a son named Mizraim, who would become the father of the people of Egypt and the people of Philistia. And so that's kind of where it started, is this moment of progeny in a cursed family. Because of a great famine later in the story of Genesis, Abraham, it says in chapter 21 of Genesis, lived as an alien in the land of the Philistines many days. So he lived there. Abraham's son Isaac also lived in the land of Philistia for a little time, but it was filled with trouble and it was short-lived. He wasn't there long. After the exodus from Egypt, God led Israel around the land of Philistia instead of through it, so that his people would not be tempted and seduced by Philistine gods. We read about that in Exodus 13. The Lord knew exactly what He's doing, because His people eventually would begin to worship the gods of the land of Philistia. And we actually talked about that this morning in church in Judges chapter 6, of how the people were worshiping Baal and Ashtoreth, these different gods of the Philistines. We read about in Scripture that the Philistines ruled over Israel for a long time in the book of Judges. And so they were there for a long time. Ehud, the judge, he killed many Philistines, but he could never defeat them. We also read about Samson. He spent his entire life fighting against the Philistines. And even in that last moment of his life, when he pushed down the pillars and killed all the Philistine rulers, he still could never fully overcome them. Why? Because he was constantly being seduced by their women. And that's, we read about that in Judges chapter 14 and chapter 16. So the Philistines were in control of Israel for a long time. During the time of Samuel, the Philistines actually defeated the Israelites in battle twice in one day. I mean, that's not a good day. It's one of the worst days in history. We read about that in 1 Samuel chapter 4. But then they carried the Ark of the Covenant away into exile. They captured the Ark of the Covenant. And there's some interesting stuff you read about during that time, but we don't have time in this sermon to really grapple with that. So after the Ark had been returned to Israel, Samuel the judge led Israel to battle against the Philistines, and the Lord defeated them in multiple victories. And it says in 1 Samuel 7, so the Philistines were subdued and did not invade Israel's territory again. So you see, there's constant battle, there's constant conflict. King Saul and his son Jonathan fought against the Philistines. David would fight against the Philistines. It'd be the Philistines that would send Goliath the giant. And that's where we are introduced to the story of David, that he came and he defeated the giant. Months later, the Philistines went to war again against them. They keep going back to combat. In fact, it would be the Philistines who would end up eventually killing Saul and his son Jonathan and the whole royal family. David, actually, when he was fleeing from Saul, lived in Philistia for a while, and he was given the city of Ziklag, the fortress of Ziklag, as his kind of base of operations. But then eventually he was the one who would conquer the Philistines in battle after he became king. And so we read all that. We're just moving through quickly through their story. So after he became king, David defeated the Philistines in 1 Chronicles 14. He carried gold and silver as tribute from them, as plunder, and then he took the last of Israel's lands back from these people. Late in David's life, he sent armies to push back a new Philistine incursion, and that's when he killed the rest of Goliath's family, all the other brothers. We talked about that in our series called The Stories They Never Told You Before. We talked about Goliath's other brothers. King Solomon ruled over the land of Philistia, and we read about that. He even received tribute from them in 1 Kings chapter 4. The prophet Elisha had some dealings with Philistia. He sent the widow, whose son he had raised from the dead, he sent her to the Philistines to avoid famine. Both King Hezekiah and King Uzziah defeated the Philistines in battle, but then wicked King Joram was defeated by them. Isaiah prophesied against Philistia, as did Jeremiah, Amos, Obadiah, and Zephaniah. There's a long history. The Philistines, there's a long history. That's the land of Philistia. We've looked at Ammon, Moab, Edom, Philistia. Let's move into the section in chapter 26. It's a long section from 26 to chapter 28 about Tyre and Sidon. Tyre and Sidon. In chapter 28, verse 26, God says about these two cities, "I will execute judgment against them and treat them with contempt." So God is very serious about this judgment we read about in the book of Ezekiel. So how did they start? How did these people, Tyre and Sidon, these two kind of city-states, how did they begin? So again, going back to the story of Noah cursing his son Ham. So Ham's son Canaan had a son named Sidon who would eventually become the founder of these two cities. That's in Genesis chapter 10. Both cities were supposed to be part of the inheritance of the tribe of Asher in the promised land, but Asher did not drive them out. They could not drive these pagans out, and so they allowed them to live in and among their people. Israel sinned by worshiping the gods of Sidon. We read about this in Judges chapter 10. They abandoned the Lord, and they did not worship him. Sometimes Tyre and Sidon are included in the land of Philistia in some biblical lists, but other times they're considered independent city-states. It's probably how the dynamics of power struggles in that day and age, how it would constantly change. Both cities are called fortresses, and King Hiram of Tyre, that's kind of hard to say, provided labor and materials later on to build David's palace. So there are some moments of maybe some friendly cooperation there, and also Solomon's temple. They were part of that as well. Craftsmen and artisans from Tyre and Sidon provided material labors to rebuild the temple later on in the time of King Cyrus of Persia. When Nehemiah and them came back, it was Tyre and Sidon who helped with that. Isaiah prophesied against Tyre and Sidon, as did Jeremiah and Zechariah. This is one of the few, though, that are going to extend into the New Testament, because Jesus himself talked about Tyre and Sidon, and he called them wicked cities in Matthew chapter 11 and Luke chapter 10. But he traveled through both of these cities, and he preached the gospel, and he did miracles. And so many people from Tyre and Sidon came to know the Lord as their Savior and came to hear him teach. And then one last connection that I really, really like about these two cities, Tyre and Sidon, is that Lydia, she was the first convert of Paul in Philippi. You read about her story in the book of Acts chapter 16. But she talked about that she was a dealer of purple cloth from the city of Thyatira. And the word Thyatira means fortress of Tyre. So this story kind of intersects with all these different parts of the Old Testament and New Testament, kind of draws the whole story together. So this nation was judged here in Ezekiel, but then later on, a woman from Tyre and Sidon becomes the head of the church, or becomes the first convert in the church at Philippi. It's a really neat thing to connect all parts of Scripture together. The next part of judgment that we read, the next section of judgment that we read, starts in Ezekiel chapter 29, and it's against Egypt. It says in my Bible, this is a prophecy of Egypt's ruin. In chapter 29, verse 2, it says, "Son of man, face Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and prophesy against him." Now, you know, if you've been in church any amount of time, you know that Egypt and the people of Israel had a long history together. I can't go through every single time that Egypt is mentioned, but there are a lot of them. Where did they start? Where did the people of Egypt start? Again, with Ham, the son of Noah. His son, Ham, had a son. After he was cursed, he had a son named Mizraim, who would become the father of Egypt and Philistia. Egypt was not always dry and dusty like a desert like it is today. At one time, it was actually considered a beautiful and lush place. It was compared to the Garden of Eden. Remember, Abraham fled down there. Isaac fled down there. Eventually, we read about in the story of Abraham that he had an Egyptian slave named Hagar, and he slept with her, had an illegitimate son named Ishmael. That all came out of Egypt. So we see Joseph's brothers in that story. They captured their brother and they sent him as a slave to Egypt. But then he rose through the ranks and became the second in command, only below Pharaoh himself, and he was able to rescue his family from famine. The people of Israel lived in Egypt for 400 years, but Egypt ended up enslaving them and mistreating them and abusing them. And so God rescued them out of the land of Egypt. And so we see that God devastated and decimated the people of Egypt to rescue his people. Even after that, though, even after being rescued from slavery, the people of Israel always wanted to return. I read that all the way through. We see this in the book of Exodus, in the book of Numbers. They're like, "We want to go back there." And Moses is like, "Why would you want to go back to the place of slavery?" It's because their hearts had become attached to the gods that the Egyptians worshipped. Israel was commanded to show kindness to Egypt in Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 7, because you were a resident alien in their land. The Lord threatened to return his people to slavery in Egypt if they didn't obey the covenant. Egypt, what it symbolizes in Scripture, is sin and disgrace. It's a picture of the world. And so when Israel entered the promised land, it was the washing away of that disgrace and that sin and that filth from the land of Egypt. Going forward in the story, King Solomon married the daughter of Pharaoh, and he secured political alliances, and this caused his heart to turn away from the Lord. He needs to stop marrying people. My goodness, how many different people from different countries is he going to marry and have his heart drawn away? And King Solomon's horses and chariots all came from Egypt. His wealth came effectively from Egypt. King Jeroboam of Israel enticed his people to worship the gods of Egypt. Egypt fought against Israel in several wars. We read about this constantly throughout the Old Testament. We also see that when Assyria came to conquer Israel, they reached out to Egypt for help. And God's like, "Don't reach out to Egypt. They're not going to be able to help you." And in fact, they didn't. But Assyria would eventually conquer both Israel and Egypt. We read about more and more battles, more and more wars, all the way throughout the times of the kings. There was a small remnant of people who escaped exile in Babylon and fled to Egypt, even though God had commanded them not to. Isaiah prophesied against Egypt, so did Jeremiah, Joel, and Zechariah. Into the New Testament, we see that when Jesus was born, Joseph and Mary took Jesus as a young boy and fled to Egypt to fulfill prophecy, to escape Herod's wrath. And that's in Matthew chapter 2. People from Egypt, this is a really interesting one. I highlighted it so I would remember to say it. People in Egypt were among the crowd on the day of Pentecost who heard Peter preach, and they saw the Holy Spirit, his power and his fire fall. And so that was kind of a moment of redemption among the people. And then it says in Isaiah chapter 19, there's another promise that Egypt will turn away from their idolatry and worship the Lord alone, and God will call them his people. So again, a moment of grace and mercy and forgiveness after everything after all the conflict they've been through throughout these years. So that was Egypt. We've looked at Ammon. We've looked at Moab. We've looked at Edom. We've looked at Sidon and Tyre. that's a great one. You guys can put that in the blooper reel. And then we've also looked at the land of Egypt. The last part of judgment that we read here in Ezekiel is in chapter 31, and he talks about Assyria. Assyria. Now we know that Assyria came through and took the people of Israel into exile, and they never returned. But they're still a force. Now, when the nation of the Empire of Babylon began to grow, it conquered the nation of Assyria. And we read about all that throughout the story in the Old Testament. This is actually the nation of Assyria. The first time it's mentioned is earlier than any of the others. It's mentioned in the Garden of Eden. It says one of the four rivers that runs through the Garden of Eden ran near the land of Assyria. So that was the first time it was actually mentioned. But it was started again in this cursed family of Ham, the son of Noah. Ham had a son named Cush, who had a son named Nimrod. And Nimrod was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Nimrod was the father of both Assyria and Babylon. In fact, the prophet Micah called Assyria the land of Nimrod. And so that's kind of where they got their start. Jonah was sent as a missionary to the land of Assyria. He was sent to Nineveh, and he preached the gospel, and the entire city of Nineveh, from the king all the way down to the lowest person, they trusted in the message that Jonah had preached. And so there was that moment, but it was not long-lasting, that repentance, just maybe a generation, because they eventually go to war against Israel. They invade Israel. They take Israel into exile. During the reign of King Ahaz, Judah was invaded by Aram, the nation of Aram, and Ahaz begged help from Assyria. So he's begging help and alliances from Israel's enemies, and that would come back to haunt him. Isaiah, Hosea, and Micah all prophesied that Israel would be taken into exile into the land of Assyria. Isaiah also prophesied that Assyria would destroy Egypt. So there's kind of interconnecting stories between all of these. We see then in the story of King Hezekiah that he woke up one day and he saw that Assyria had besieged his city, the city of Jerusalem, and he went out and realized, okay, what are we going to do? God says, don't be afraid of them. And so he decided to trust in the Lord, and God came that night and destroyed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. So that was this an amazing moment of God's sovereignty, God's power, God's omnipotent control. We see just constant conflict between the people of Assyria and the people of Israel. Isaiah prophesied against Assyria, and so did Zephaniah and Zechariah. In fact, the entire book of Nahum is devoted to the Lord's judgment against Assyria. If you're thinking, I would love to read some more judgment today, go ahead and read the book of Nahum. We studied it last year together on Wednesday night as a church, but if you want to read that. One thing we see, the last thing I want to show you about them is that in Isaiah chapter 19, verses 23 through 25, Assyria, it says, God promises that one day they will turn from their idolatry, worship the Lord alone, and God will call them his handiwork. So this, again, a moment of grace and love. Okay, that's it. I promise I'm finished at this point. I know that this was just a very unique way to look at these books. I know that you're thinking, my goodness, I just don't know what to think about that. But if you're a history lover, maybe you got something out of it. But if not, that's okay. I'm so glad that you stuck with me to this point, if you did stick with me to this point. I'm glad you did, because like we said, all of God's words from beginning to end, they are from Genesis 1:1 all the way through the end of Revelation, they are profitable for us. They're words of life. They proclaim the story of the gospel, every single section. So here from Ezekiel 25 to 32, he's proclaiming the story of the gospel. Judgment is falling on sinful nations, but those eventually we'll see, it points us forward to those that trust in the name of Jesus Christ for their salvation will be rescued from that judgment. In the same way that we talked about Noah earlier. Remember, there was judgment falling on this world, and he built the ark and entered into the ark with his family, and he was saved because of that. That faith in that rescue. In the same way, Jesus became our ark. He became our method of salvation. When we come to him and we come to him for salvation, we trust in him, he takes us in and shields us and protects us from the judgment that's to come. If you believe in Jesus Christ, on the day of judgment, God will look at you and he will not see your sin, but he'll see his son. Jesus will plead your cause and say, no, you cannot judge him. That is one of mine. What a great promise that we have. We deserve judgment, but God gave us mercy instead. That's the takeaway I want you to see from this section here in the book of Ezekiel. Allow me to pray for you, if you would. Father, thank you for the gift of salvation we have in Jesus Christ. We did not deserve it. We did not earn it. But we enjoy it freely through the one who gave his life for us on the cross. Thank you, Lord, that we can enjoy the good news of the gospel, that it will remind us of the love and the grace and the mercy and the forgiveness we have in Jesus. Thank you for that, Lord. I beg you, Lord, that you would help us to see every verse in Scripture as profitable, that we would see even the verses that we don't maybe not understand or maybe not enjoy as much, that you would give us hearts of reverence and hearts of devotion to your word. Thank you, Lord, for this time that we've had to study together. We ask all of these things, Lord. We ask you to bless us in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. All right, church, this was an interesting time, an interesting study in the book of Ezekiel. We're going to continue on next week. I would encourage you to come back and join us there on September 13th, Sunday, September 13th. That's actually the target date that we're planning on coming back together and regathering in person for our Sunday night service. Now, they will still be live streamed, but that's the date we're aiming to come back together and join together and be regathered together. So it's going to be a fantastic day. We'll talk about it as it gets a little closer. I hope you guys have a fantastic week and that you be blessed.